Welcome.
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 Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
It's a beautiful day.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
To let it get away. It's a beautiful day.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
An online ministry of Belgrade Avenue United Methodist Church.
Well, good morning, Belgrade Avenue Church and anyone else who's with us right now. I'm Dan Crandall, and I'm the pastor here at Belgrade. Thank you so much for joining us this morning and logging on together with us. We are so, so glad that you've decided to join us and are here this morning. Our prayer is that you will encounter Jesus more deeply and be inspired to live into his kingdom in new and beautiful ways. Well, this morning we're going to get right into it. I've got a lot I want to say today, so I'm going to start with prayer right off the bat, and then we'll get right to it. So wherever you are right now, would you go ahead and bow your head, and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this week. God, I just ask that as we worship together this morning in this distance fashion, that you would knit our hearts together through your Holy Spirit. And as you do that, that we would learn and we would grow and we would come to see you, Jesus, as the number one in our hearts. Not only that, Lord, but that as we live into your kingdom, God, that you would create desires in our hearts that are the same desires that you have in your hearts, Lord, in your heart. And so, Father, I pray for those in our congregation that are struggling. I pray for those that are struggling in their bodies, Lord, that you would give them a touch of your healing power and heal their bodies. God, give them reprieve from their pain and their sicknesses and their diseases and any ailment they might be suffering from. I pray that we'd be a healed and whole congregation by your Spirit. Not only that, Lord, but I pray that those that are struggling in finances, God, that you would give also reprieve and education and help us to get out of the crushing grips of debt and financial struggles. Lord, help us to flourish so that we can serve others with what we have. Not only that, Lord, but I pray for those that are struggling in relationships, God, that you would bring understanding and listening and reconciliation as much as possible. Maybe not like it looked like before, but in a new way. God, those that are need a new job, that are struggling with their work, I pray that you would give the power to get wealth as you promised you would in Scripture, and help us to find meaningful ways to use the giftings and the talents you've put in our hearts and the skills you've caused us to formed and shaped in us to acquire throughout our lives to be put to good use. I pray that you would give us ways to get wealth that are using what you've given us in meaningful ways also for your kingdom. God, I pray for our community that you would bring peace and shalom. And God, for our church, that you would start with us, that you would bring us peace and shalom, and help us above all to be an understanding people who don't look at issues in a homogenous way, that don't look at issues in our world in such a black and white rigid way, but God, that you'd, as you said in Proverbs, give us above all understanding. And I pray that for us, Lord. I pray that you would help us to be a people that always look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, as you said in the Scriptures. So help us to do that right now. Lord, we turn our eyes and our attentions to the words that you've taught us to pray when you were on this earth. And church, would you say this together with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, Almighty Father, now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. So church, could you do me a favor? I'd like you to think about your most favorite pet you've ever had in your life. And in the comments around this video, would you let us know what was the name and type of animal that pet was? And while you do that, here's a video of my favorite pet, which happens to be the one that we have now. This is Bruno, our boxer, playing with one of his favorite toys. 1, 2, 3, go.
Everyone, I'm Lindsay Morrison and I will be bringing you your shout outs today. Our first shout out goes to Lori Dundas and Judy Watts, who both celebrated a birthday on the 13th. We love you ladies and we pray that this year brings you so much joy. Our next shout out goes to Burl Maker, who celebrates his birthday today on August 16th. Happy birthday, Burl. Your church family is celebrating with you today. The next shout out goes to Dave and Beulah Knoll, who are celebrating 56 years together this past week. We're so happy for y'all. Happy anniversary. Shout out to Glenn Siegfried, who celebrates a birthday on the 17th. Glenn, try not to party too hard. Your neighbors might get suspicious. You are a blessing to us, Glenn. And our final shout out goes to Karen Dungan, who will celebrate her birthday on the 19th. Happy birthday, Karen. You are so special to us, and we're so happy you're part of our church family. Well, that's it for shoutouts this week. If you have a shoutout that you'd like us to include in Belgrade Online, be sure to email the office, and we will be sure to embarrass, maybe celebrate them this week. I'm Lindsay Morrison. Have a great week.
Our gospel reading today is from Mark 10, verses 17 through 22. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments: do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, do not defraud, honor your mother and father." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said, "go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. This is a word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, we are in our final 2 weeks of our series, People of Reconciliation, Christ's Ambassadors. And we've been talking about the five phases that we go through in order to reach across the aisles, to cross boundaries, and restore relationships, whether that's between people groups, between nations, between races, or friends, or co-workers, or family members, or even spouses. And so far, we've talked about catalytic events. And we talked about the catalytic events as being the straw that breaks the camel's back, that shocks us and gets our attention and causes us to wake up. And then we talked about number two, the phase of realization, the period where we begin to realize that there are other viewpoints and there's other experiences than ours that are equally as valid as ours. And there's also the phase of identification. And this is the phase that we talked about last week, where our views start to shift and we begin building friendships with those that are other than us. And so this week we're going to talk about the final two steps. We're going to mesh them together and talk about the last two phases, 4 and 5, today. And those are the phase of number 4, preparation, and number 5, activation. And today we're going to talk about those, the final two pieces to the puzzle. And let me tell you, we're going to drink from the fire hose today. So let's take a deep breath, center ourselves, focus, and let's pray together before we dig in. Won't you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for this time when we can learn and grow together. God, I pray that we'd hear from you today, that my words would not be my own, but they'd come straight from you. I pray that we'd all have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts that understand. And may we be transformed in this process and build your kingdom in this world. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, I'm a pastor, obviously. And as a pastor, I love people. And more specifically, I love relationships and getting to know people and understanding their stories and more deeply. And I really love laughing and talking about anything and everything. But here's the thing. I'm technically an introvert, but I'm an introvert that really loves people. I'm very, very relational. One of the occupational hazards, though, of having that kind of a gift mix is that I have a tendency to, despise structure and order. I tend to feel like I do better without a lot of structure and order. However, you know, I'd much rather just have an organic party in my living room, call it a church, and be done with it. You know, but in the last 18 years or so of ministry, I've learned that although that way of thinking can be an asset many times, it can also be a hindrance if it isn't balanced with something. And that kind of a free spiritedness, it's got to have a balance. It has to have a balance. And this is the kind of a balance that I used to really look down upon when I was younger, but now I highly value. And that's something that this balance, this thing that without it, people like me can't really flourish, even though we don't like to admit it. And this is something that can be found on the picture on your screen right now. And on this picture on your screen, you're seeing a beautiful display. There's vines growing into a gorgeous canopy over this walkway. And although there are many elements to this picture, there's one thing in particular that if it was missing, would make this picture look very different. And that thing is structure. Without structure, the vines in this picture would be a pile of weeds on the ground and there would be no walkway at all. Because vines need structure to grow on. And in the same way, relationships and relational connections need structure to grow. Put it this way, relational connections cannot be sustained without structural intentionality. We have to be intentional about building structures to sustain our relationships. To some people, like the old version of myself, structure is a dirty word. You know, you can live in an unstructured life for a while. But if we're honest with ourselves, when we live an unstructured life, it'll only get us so far. Because pretty soon our effectiveness will reach a cap and we'll either learn to grow or we start to move backwards. And God has called you, God has called me, God has called us all to growth. God has called us to grow, and growth needs structure. And so in this phase, in this fourth phase of reconciliation, after responding to a catalytic event and after realizing a whole host of things about yourself and the world around you and shifting your perspective and building relationships with those who are other than you and forming new cultural identities, there needs to be a measure of structure that is added in order to prepare us. And in this phase, in the preparation phase, this is all about structure that will sustain our new shared life together. So in order to get people to work together, for instance, employers need a measure of structure to keep everything moving, right? In order for two lovers to enjoy a shared life together, their lives need this thing called a home that is a place of personalized structure for everyone's safety and benefit. We have this thing called marriage, the structured institution to keep us on a path of growth. And when we're talking about reconciliation, structure is essential because without it, the pressure and the tendency to become complacent will pull you backwards like vines and gravity. And then also like the vines, all will be is weeds. To be clear, I'm talking about healthy structures. Healthy structures are about growth and about flourishing. What I'm not talking about is sometimes you can actually have too much structure. And you get to the place where the structure becomes rigid, it can become toxic, it can become manipulative, and it can become controlling. You can't eliminate all of the chaos because that's not healthy either. Here's the thing, we've got to go through seasons of chaos to get to seasons of stability. And a healthy perspective of structure will help to get us there. But we have to have a solid sense of identity, like we talked about last week, in order to keep moving forward. And so that's the hard work of this number four, this phase, this preparation phase, structuring and preparing our families, our businesses, and our communities, and our churches to be able to not only handle, but absolutely flourish in our work of reconciliation. So some questions that we have to ask when we're building structure into ourselves is, who are we? You know, some of these identity questions that also kind of overlap with last week's message. Who are we? What's our mission? What are our goals? How will we know when we're hitting those goals? What's our scoreboard? What is blocking us from reconciling with others on a large scale and on a personal scale? What are we afraid of as a people? What scares us and why? You know, these kinds of questions prepare us, and they prepare you and our people for the hard work, because they sharpen our plan and our sense of identity. And here's the turning point. When we begin to add this kind of intentional structure into our midst, our mindset will begin to shift and begin to change. And instead of just having a punch in and punch out mindset with life or with this thing, we'll shift into a mindset of ownership, where we own this. And it's not just something where, you know, we're not caring about, you know, what do we have to do to check the box and move on so we can get on with our day. Instead of that, our whole heart and our mind and our actions will be invested in our efforts. It's the difference of like being an employee at a store and being a partner in owning the store. Your heart will be in completely different places as an employee versus an owner. So we got to get out of the mindset of being an employee in the work of reconciliation. Well, I did my deed. I have a black friend. I have a Hispanic friend. I have somebody in my life who's an atheist. We move beyond that and say, no, I'm building relationships, and I want to learn, I want to understand, I want to build a partnership with these people and reach across the aisle and learn and have them learn, and we begin to prepare the way for reconciliation. It's also like the difference between going to church and being the church. You know, you can, well, I went to church this week. That's a wrong mindset to have. Versus being the church. I am the church. I own this mission of Jesus. It's not just something I do on a Sunday real quick. God never commanded going to church, but he always expected us to be the church, and he still does. So in this phase, in the preparation phase, this is where most people give up. And in our scripture today from Mark chapter 10, verses 17 to 22, a young man had done all the right things, or checked all the right boxes, and wanted to do well in life. But Jesus presented him a different kind of a pattern. Jesus kind of revealed to him that he was having this transactional mindset to life, this punch in, punch out, this employee mindset. And Jesus presents him with the mindset of ownership. He presents him with a pattern for transformation. But the young guy decided that it was too high of a cost for him, and he walked away from Jesus. And many people in this phase don't even realize they're counting the cost as too high when they give up. Sometimes they just get tired and stagnate. I've been there, and maybe you've been there as well. Because when we've achieved a new perspective and we get some new friends that are diverse from us, and the task of reconciliation on a larger scale just doesn't seem as urgent. You know, we've done our part, right? But this is why we need structures to help us through these fuzzy times, to help us remind us that we need to continue to prepare ourselves to finish the work. And this prepares us for the fifth and final phase, which is the activation phase. Cornel West said that justice is what love looks like in public. Justice is what love looks like in public. And that's right, reconciliation is all about justice. Not the punishment kind of justice, retributive justice, but restorative justice. The kind of justice that seeks to restore a person, restore a relationship, restore a people, restore people's sense of unity and togetherness again. Rebuilding together that which has been torn down. That is the God kind of justice, and that is reconciliation. Not so that we don't rebuild so that it'll even look the same or be the same, but that in a new way, it'll bring new life and new vitality. And so we activate this new way in our world. And this is all about asking the question, how now shall we live? You know, what then shall we do? After going through this a catalytic event and phases of realization and waking up and a new identity of relationships and preparing for some new way of life in organization and in life. So we ask the question, you know, what then shall we do? And so now it's time in our journey where we set into motion that which the catalytic event has pushed us to face. What the realization phase has opened our eyes to, what the identification phase has connected us with, who the identification phase has connected us with, and how the preparation phase has structured our way forward. This is where the most learning takes place. Because nobody ever learns more in a classroom than the teacher. So in this activation phase, here's a couple things that we can do. Here's a couple things that we can do and keep in mind as we move forward in this work of reconciliation. And this can be remembered as the acronym of CARE. C-A-R-E, CARE. And this stands for communicate, advocate, relate, and educate. CARE. So the first thing we can do is communicate. We can communicate what it is that we've learned. We have a power. You have power and you have a voice. And it's time to use it. Continue listening and learning, but this is the time where we begin to talk about what we've been listening to and what we've learned already. So we need to start communicating. We need to start speaking out and we need to start talking and being a voice and using our power to communicate the things that we've learned to reconcile. And this could look like a number of different things. This could be speaking up to your crazy uncle that loves to tell that racist joke. This could be speaking up to your spouse when you feel like things aren't going well and you need to mend some wounds. This could mean calling that long lost friend that you've lost touch with because of some strange rift. Whatever it is, you got to communicate. You got to speak up. That's the C in CARE. And then we've got A, we advocate. Once you've spoken up, you're not done. Now you need to hustle. You need to get up, and it's time to get involved and advocate for actual change. Talking isn't enough. Reverend Vernon Johns, who was the minister to Martin Luther King Jr., said this: if you see a good fight, get in it. If you see a good fight, get in it. And I would even add to that, just make sure that the fight you're in is something that Jesus wants you to fight for. Because too many Christians are out there advocating and fighting for things that are anti-kingdom. But if we follow Jesus, then our hills to die on are justice and peace, mercy and reconciliation in Jesus Christ. We need to learn to advocate and actually act on what we're speaking up in regards for. It's time to act. It's time to reach across the aisles. Ask, you know, if you're a Republican, ask a Democrat out to lunch. If you're a Democrat, ask a Republican about to lunch. Get into a respectful conversation where you're trying to learn what they understand what they actually believe instead of trying to assert what you do. Maybe it's time, this is the phase where it's time to go forward and get that marriage counseling you've been talking about. Maybe this is the phase where you need to step out and join that organization that seeks to mend divides. Maybe it's time to join the NAACP and join that fight. There's so many different ways you can stand up and do something. It's time to advocate, not just speak. You definitely need to speak. You need to communicate, but you also need to start to advocate in action as well. The scriptures say, beloved, let us not love in word alone, but also in deed and in action. So let's follow suit. So we've got communicate, we've got advocate. R means relate in this acronym CARE. Relate. We can't do this work alone. You cannot reconcile a marriage or navigate a divorce alone. You can't fight for civil rights alone. You can't serve Jesus alone. We need to constantly be relating to those who share our convictions, who share our passions, and share our mission to serve Jesus Christ by helping to heal a broken world and the broken relationships in that world, between people and between groups. And this is always easier said than done. And finding such a group could take years. But I gotta say, that's why I'm so privileged to pastor one of those communities here at Belgrade Avenue UMC, because I'm so proud of the hard work that this congregation does to serve our community in big and small ways. But it's important to realize that we can't do it alone. Reconciliation always, always is a relational endeavor. So we've got communicate, we've got advocate, we've got relate, and finally we've got educate. Here's a new commandment I, Pastor Dan, giveth unto you. Are you ready? Here we go. Dan Zimmerly's going to put it on the screen. Say it with me. Thou shalt never stop learning. You must commit to being a lifelong learner. We never arrive in this life. The minute we stop growing is the minute we begin to die. So don't stagnate. Continue shifting and continue changing, which means that you'll have to continue growing up new structures. And that's hard for people to swallow, but it's reality. You will never learn more than when you are teaching others, and that's just a fact. So never stop learning. And in this activation phase, as you never stop learning, and you begin to step out and use and act and advocate, you will also be educating yourself, because no one ever learns more than the teacher. So never ever stop learning. So that's the acronym CARE. We communicate, we advocate, we relate, and we educate ourselves in community with others, in action and in word. So as we close, what does this look like in practice? I'm going to read to you a portion from this book by Brenda Salter McNeil. And she writes this story. So what does it look like practically for us to live this out? There's a church in Englewood, New Jersey that shows us what it means to actively C-A-R-E, care. One Sunday, rather than having a regular worship service, Metro Community Church decided to walk around and pray for their community. So they divided the city into areas within a 4 to 5 block radius around their church. The whole church went outside and prayed for homes and for families and schools and businesses, offices, municipal buildings, streets, and even other churches. On that walk, the pastor prayed repeatedly and implored God to, quote, break my heart for what breaks your heart, God. And eventually he had an idea. We need to have folks in our church live among the neighborhoods in this community. So Englewood is a city located in New Jersey near the border of New York. With approximately 28,000 people, it's the 87th most populated state in the city, in the state of New Jersey, with the largest racial and ethnic groups being African-Americans at 34%, whites at 27%, and Hispanics at 22%. And like many cities, Englewood has had its share of challenges. One pressing issue is that the city sends the highest number of juveniles to their detention centers. Over time, this pastor and his church realized that the greatest need in their community was to help reach the at-risk youth in their community. So as a result of the prayer walk that Sunday, the church bought a house in the community, and it's called the Metro House. And 5 single men live there, intentionally reaching out to serve their neighbors, and one of the men is now running the program, working with the most at-risk youth in the city. Metro Life, L-I-F-E, Living in Freedom Every Day, is an incredible holistic program that is both practical and intentional, that includes mentoring, life skills, tutoring, working with families, college prep classes, and justice advocacy. And the Metro House has also become a safe haven for young people hoping to avoid gangs. Eventually, the church hopes to build a community center that's a nonprofit organization in partnership with the city. Government officials, school principals, and the local police have taken notice. They are all impressed with this church's active involvement within this community. Off the record, several of them have said to the pastor, "These kids don't need another government program. They need Jesus." And this is the activation phase being lived out at its best. bringing healing, wholeness, justice, and reconciliation to communities while pointing people to Jesus. So this activation phase is where we roll up our sleeves and use the talents and the giftings and the abilities and the resources and the skills that God has given us to heal brokenness in our communities. And listen, church, we can't do this without the breath of the Holy Spirit, without the Ruach in Hebrew or the Pneuma in Greek, the Spirit of God, the breath of God. We can't do this without the Spirit. It's only by the power of the Holy Spirit that we can do this difficult work of reconciliation. I love that phrase in that story that the pastor said that he prayed, God, break my heart for what breaks yours. Church, may we pray that same prayer. May our hearts break for that which breaks the heart of God. So let's fix our eyes on our Hosanna and worship together. Let's sing this song.
Eternity.
Church, would you bow your heads and pray with me? Oh, Hosanna in the highest, our God, our Creator, our King, our Developer, our Reconciler. Would you break our hearts for that which breaks your heart? Would you create this revival of reconciliation in the Holy Spirit to point people to you, Jesus, and to build your kingdom on this earth as it is in heaven? Do that in us and through us, God, I pray. I beg you, Lord. We need your Spirit. We need a move of God in our hearts and our minds and in our communities and our churches and our lives. Without you, it'll never get done. Politics and government programs, no matter what side, will always fall short. But you always cut straight to the heart. So cut our hearts so that we bleed for the world, so much so that we do something about it and pursue reconciliation. We love you, Lord. May your will be done in and through us. And bless us that we may bless others. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, church, that's it for this week. Make sure that you join us next week for the conclusion of this series. And as you log off this morning, may you embrace new structures to carry you through chaos. May you take ownership of this difficult work of reconciliation, and may you practice activating what you've learned and put it into action. I love and miss you all so much. Have a wonderful, wonderful week. Grace and peace be to you. Bye for now. Cup there. Thanks. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm gonna be getting that noise. Okay. Okay. Are you recording right now?
Yeah.
You're recording through?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
I just fired it up and I figure, you know, when you
get
going,
I'll okay. There's a cricket in here. Gosh, sorry, my watch is like buzzing like crazy. All right, I'm gonna redo that sentence. So the pressure and the complacency... Okay. There's a quote by Cornel West that says, "Justice is what love looks like in public." Justice is what love looks like in public. And that's exactly right. Because reconciliation is all about justice. Not punishment, which is retributive justice. Excuse me. Are you speaking in tongues? All right. Because we're not talking about punishment. Okay. All right. I'm just going to start over.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Lindsay Morrison, and I will be... Sorry.
That's so great. I know. I was like, this chair, I feel like it's so long, too. Oh, but I was really trying to be still. I think I made it without doing it this time.
Yes.
Usually
yes.
I do. I'm like, and you try to show on your face.
Right. You're like, oh, I
don't know. Like you had plastic surgery.
Ayo.
Hey.
Jeez. You don't.
Sorry.
All right. It's on airplane mode, so nobody can call and interrupt again.
Mic's plugged in.
Yeah. Like it was good.